Unfortunately, we had some audio issues with this week's podcast on my end. So I've tried to cut out as much of my speaking as possible to make it an easier listening experience. I apologize for that. Hello, and welcome to Self-Sufficient Conversations. I am your host, Natalie, and we will be talking with Tini from Casio Lino in this week's episode in our podcast series, where we explore what self-sufficiency means to others. Tini Gardens, in her 800 meter square block in Germany, she was once someone who didn't like to garden until she moved to a new home. But now she has a beautiful and abundant backyard and grew over 100 different varieties of food last year. Can you please tell us what self-sufficiency looks like for you?
Yeah, hi, nice to have me here. And self-sufficiency means for me that I'm growing as much fruits and vegetables as I can. And I can promise you I'm growing really a lot. Last year in 2020, I've grown 950 kilograms of fruits and vegetables, which is quite awesome, I think.
That's
especially
amazing.
For my, especially for my, for the size of my garden. In my backyard garden, I have perhaps about 300 square meters growing space, and I have grown there more than 500 kilograms. And the other 400 I've grown in our paradise. It's our paradise. It's called it's a normal meadow we have rented from a farmer, and I'm growing there some staple foods as well.
Lovely. 900 kilos is amazing. I think you're going to inspire so many people from that.
Yeah, but you have to remember that I'm in Germany and we can't grow so much food during winter time. So we have to, we can extend our seasons a bit, but we have to grow most of our food in late spring, summer, and early autumn.
That's so a lot of food coming out of a small space, though. That's really phenomenal. And inspiring. Can you tell us a bit about your garden?
In my garden, I have just a normal garden beds, but I'm growing my food also in some waste beds, which aren't so high, which just have an frame around, which is quite handy because we struggle a bit with roots and they're eating everything from the down.
Voles are like little creatures that live in the ground.
I see, you don't know them in Australia. Well, you can be lucky. There's a lot of them. There are big mice, I think, and they prefer to eat the roots of the plants. Mm-hmm. And you know what happens when the root is missing?
Yeah.
They like to eat potatoes. Carrots and beetroots and so on.
Oh, no.
So the waste beds have the point that I can lay some wire below so they can't reach the roots of the plants. It's quite heavy. I'm using a lot of bokashi, but I'm just doing it in the wire beds because otherwise the voles would have a party down there. Yeah, because I think they love fermented compost.
Okay.
And bokashi is not than fermented compost.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think, and because of the bokashi, I can grow such a high amount of vegetables in such a small space.
Wow.
And going in a small space was always my biggest intention. But a few years ago, we really had to rent a piece of land from a farmer because, I can grow a lot, but not the staple foods.
Okay.
And especially by staple foods, they make really a difference. They make really a difference for eating and for being self-sufficient and so on.
Agreed. And what would you class as your staple foods that you're growing on the rented piece of land?
My staple foods are mostly potatoes, pumpkins. I'm growing not so many varieties, perhaps just 5 or 6 varieties of pumpkins, but mostly around 200 or 300 kilograms of pumpkins. Oh, we're eating something else. And cabbage and kale, of course.
Okay. Yeah.
Germany is a nation of kale and cabbage eating people.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's perfect. It's high on vitamin C, and you can almost harvest some kale types at kale varieties during the whole winter.
Wow.
So yeah, it's quite awesome, especially for our climate.
Do you get snow where you are?
When I was a child, we got snow. By now, well, in Germany, we have snow, no question. But I'm in the northern part of Germany, and there's not so much snow. Last week, we had about 10 centimeters in the morning, and it was gone at lunch. Yeah, but it was gone at lunch.
Yeah, but that means that you can still grow a few things in your garden through the winter months.
But snow isn't the problem. I think the cold temperatures rather the problem, because when you have covered your plants or your vegetables with snow, it's like an isolation layer on the plant. So when it gets cold, like -7, -8, -10, I don't know, which can happen here, the plants don't freeze so hard.
Okay.
Snow isn't too bad.
Yeah. And so you think your Bekashi compost has been a game changer in your garden?
Yeah, definitely.
So the Bekashi has allowed you to add more organic matter to the clay to make it workable?
Exactly. Yeah, organic matter, and it fertilizes like crazy. It's
really
amazing. Yeah.
Bekashi isn't something I've tried before, but it's something that intrigues me.
Yeah, you definitely should, and I like to compare it with sauerkraut.
Okay.
Because sauerkraut has so many good effects on your health, and I think it's the same with Bokashi and your plants, because it's the same, it's fermented the same way.
Okay. Yeah.
And I can really see a difference between beds I have fertilized with Bokashi and beds without Bokashi.
Do you put that underneath the mulch, or do you then put that in your compost bin? And then the compost
bin? Yeah, you have to dig a little hole.
Okay.
You have to dig a little hole and lay the Bokashi in and then cover it. And you shouldn't plant in a bed freshly where you have put Bokashi in freshly. You have to wait perhaps 1 or 2 weeks, and then you can plant, because it's still a bit acid.
Okay. Yeah.
And the roots of the plants would burn. You have to wait 1 or 2 weeks after using Bokashi. But you could, for example, you could directly sow in this bed. Okay. Because until the seeds germinate and the roots go down, the Bokashi is just gone.
Okay. Wow. That's really interesting.
It just composts it. During summertime, when it's warm enough, it takes, I think, about 3 weeks until the Bokashi is almost gone.
Wow, that's amazing. That's something I will have to look into.
You should.
Mm. Do you have to buy the microbes to start the fermentation process? Or like, how does that system work?
Yeah, you have to use some kind of microbes to get them started.
Do you make your own microbes?
Yeah, you can have a kind of liquid, or you can have a kind of powder, or you could use EM. I don't know if you know them, EM.
Yeah, I make my own EM.
Yeah, so you could use it.
Oh, wow, okay. I will be looking into that this week. And because I've got some EM sitting there.
Yeah, it's a perfect way to use it. And you could even use like old bread or leftovers. You just have to throw away. Well, I know we try to avoid to throw things away, but sometimes it just happened. You can't change it. And then you can put it into the Bokashi, and it's still useful for something.
Fantastic. That's really, really exciting. Do you think you guys are mainly self-sufficient from your backyard and your leaf meadow, or are you still purchasing from the supermarket?
Well, of course we have to buy some groceries, like essentials. I can't grow my own coffee. I can't grow my own wheat and sugar and so on. But I think when it comes to fruits and vegetables, well, I have to buy bananas. They definitely won't go in Germany. And I'm buying ginger as well. Mm-hmm. But I think that's mostly it. That's wow. mostly.
That's really amazing.
And we are eating quite a lot of vegetables. And we have our own honey as well, because my hubby is a semi-professional beekeeper. And I'm doing all my baking and sweetening I do with our own honey. So yeah, our monthly grocery bill isn't very high.
Very much the same.
But I'm still buying some stuff. And when I'm really, really hungry for a special kind of vegetable or food, I just buy it.
Yes,
but
yes.
It doesn't happen very often.
Yes.
Yeah, and I think it's you're coming to the time problem, because your days are just having 24 hours. And
that's right.
If you want to, if you want to make everything by yourself, it's not enough.
Yeah.
I've tried it.
Yes, so have I. I remember the first time I tried to grow chickpeas, and I was so disappointed at how few chickpeas I got off a crop. There's literally two peas in a pod, and the amount of time it took to shell them and for half a cup of chickpeas. So I decided that I could sell excess garlic, and that could buy me, you know, my 5 to 10 kilos of chickpeas for the year. And same with dried beans. It's just such a hassle to shell them. Like, it takes a lot of time and growing space.
Yeah, that's definitely true. I'm trying. I'm still not there now. I'm trying to grow my own kidney beans.
Because
the only kidney beans you can buy here, they're coming from China. And I don't want to eat kidney beans. Mm-hmm. And to grow them by your own, we are eating a lot of kidney beans during the year. It's quite amazing.
Yeah. Kidney beans were one that was more prolific of the lot. I'm actually trying Bellotti beans again this year, but more variety.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see how many I get off my bed and if it really is worth it.
I have a variety of Bellotti beans, which you can grow like mana beans.
Yes, yes.
And I think they're more clever. Because you have a higher yield.
Yeah.
Yeah. To the space.
That's right. And can you talk us through your cellar? You've got this amazing cellar, and we had a brief chat before we went on air about how it's normal in Germany to have a cellar, but here in Australia it's really not normal. It's actually a real big dream of mine to have a root cellar. And if I was to have one, it would be an external structure to the house. Can you tell us a little bit about yours and how you use it to store your food?
Yeah, you're definitely right. Most of the houses in Germany have a cellar, but the newer ones are just too warm to store anything in there. Ours is about 14 to 16 degrees,
wow.
Which isn't, it's cooler, but it isn't quite perfect.
Okay.
So in my cellar, I'm storing all my jars and my potatoes as well, and my apples. Also, it's not cold enough, mm-hmm. but it's a good way to have a storage room, a big pantry. Mm-hmm. And therefore, because of the temperature, I have two root cellar. We built two root cellar in our garden.
Oh, wow.
They are made from an old washing machine drum,
okay.
which is in the and we covered it with some straw around, and on top we have some styrofoam to store the cold and to make sure that the content isn't freezing
mm-hmm.
inside. And this is quite perfect, because I can store my carrots and my beetroots until next summer almost.
Wow.
If I haven't eaten.
Yeah. Yeah, that's amazing.
In my normal cellar, I'm having all my pumpkins. I'm storing all my pumpkins because they don't like it too cold. But not over 20 degrees, so 16 to 18 degrees are just perfect there. And I'm using my cellar as well for propagating my plants.
Oh, wow.
My seedlings.
Okay.
Yeah, because the temperature in our living room or in the rest of the house would just be too high.
Okay.
Because when you have 20 degrees, they just, when you have lettuce or cabbage plant, they will just grow too fast and it wouldn't make sense. So with 16 degrees, it's just perfect. And I can just place them in the cellar and they are out of my sight.
Yeah. Do you use lights to help them grow?
Yeah. I'm using some growing lights.
Yeah.
And you can place them everywhere. So you can just put them in the cellar downstairs.
Yeah. Awesome. I like that idea. I've seen photos of your cellar on Instagram. And if you don't follow Teeny, you should go over and follow her because she's got a beautiful, colourful Instagram grid. And one of the photos that she recently posted was of her cellar and all the preserves in there. Can I ask you how you learnt how to ferment and preserve your own food?
Well, I just had to learn it at one point because I've grown too much that we could eat it all at once. And so, yeah, I was asking my grandma and some older people in our village because, it's the knowledge has been almost lost in our culture. And by now it's coming back time by time. But, and I just tried. You have to try everything and try so long as you have success. I think that's the only way.
Last year, you grew over 100 different varieties in your garden, in your 100 veg challenge. So in January, can you talk us through the process of how you came up with the challenge?
The idea came up with two Instagram friends of mine. And we wanted to try to grow as much different varieties as we can. And we just wanted to count it because it's like, it's rather a challenge when you're counting it. And when you're making it public, it's even more challenging. They asked me if I would like to join. And I said, yeah, of course. Yeah, I don't know if I reach the goal or not, but it's just fun.
Yeah.
And I've really learned a lot during that year. Regarding my varieties, and I was looking at them very clearly to see if I want to grow them again or not. And in the end, I ended up with I think about 150 varieties.
Wow.
Don't ask me if it's 140 or 150, something like that. And I think if you are interested in it, you can have a look on my internet page on my website. And it was just fun, this challenge.
I love the variety.
Sometimes when I was doing my Instagram post in the morning, I had to have a look. Oh, which number? That's the right number. I didn't want to count a double, but it was fun.
Nice. Did you find any new favorites?
I think I found some, and on my website I marked them with 3 stars in the end. The list on my website is more for myself and for others because I wanted just to write down which are my favorites and which I would like to grow again and so on. But I have to try new varieties every year. That's just a fact. And just to get new varieties, but we had a similar, perhaps not so awful, but we had a similar problem here in Germany as well with the seeds, and all the gardening centers were closed and so on. And I'm growing a high amount of seeds for myself, but not all. For example, I don't like to use cucumber or pumpkin or zucchini seeds for my own plants because I'm always a bit afraid of cross-pollination and so on.
Yeah.
And even brassicas. Sometimes I'm having some own brassica seeds, but mostly I just buy them. It's easier.
It is easier. I agree.
Yeah. Yeah. And for example, in our paradise one year, I had a cross pollination between a curly kale and a black kale, it's quite lovely. I'm always growing just this variety, but I don't want to have a cross pollination between a broccoli and a curly kale or something like that. It wouldn't make sense.
Yeah.
And I think self-sufficiency is not a job, it's a kind of lifestyle.
For us,
it definitely became a kind of lifestyle, and you're starting so many other things as well, not just growing your own food, but you're collecting more water and you're trying to store energy wherever you can, and baking your own bread, even if you have to buy the grains and so on. That's a real lifestyle.
Yeah, you're right. Not always easy, but I suppose small changes often can kind of get you there.
Yeah, but life is never easy, so.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Do you have any tips for people who are gardening in small spaces, how to maximize their harvest?
I'm going in a small space as well, so I should have some tips. I don't know. I try to use really every single spot and every corner, and I started a few years ago to draw a garden plan for my whole garden and to have a look where are some spaces which are not optimally used, or where are some spaces where I can place, for example, a berry bush or something like that. And another tip would be to start with polyculture or permaculture. I really like the polyculture approach, where you can plant almost every plant together, just to have a look that they can increase their yield by living together, mm-hmm. by growing together, and just try to extend your season. Because it's not necessary, even in Germany, that your garden beds are empty during almost half of the year. So you can extend your season. You can, the autumns are getting warmer, the springs are earlier, so you can just extend it. And there are so many varieties you can harvest during winter, because they are just staying there and waiting for being harvested. So just try it.
Do you forage where you are?
Yeah. Blackberries, elderberry flowers, some weeds, the dandelions and nettles and so on.
Okay, lovely.
And rosehips are really good as well. What? Yeah, you can make a perfect, deliciously jelly, jam, which is really good. It's very time craving, but it's really good. Okay. Or you could use them in a tea mixture.
Okay.
Or you could dry them and make a powder of it.
Okay.
Just to add to your muesli in the morning or in your smoothie or whatever.
Nice.
Yeah, but be careful with the little seeds inside, because they're itchy. You need to remove the seeds.
Okay.
Yeah. When you place the seeds on your hand, you have to scratch like crazy.
Oh wow! Okay.
Yeah.
And what would be your biggest piece of advice for anyone wanting to start their self-sufficient journey?
Well, I would suggest to start small. To start small and grow bigger, because otherwise it would be overwhelming. If you can grow big, of course, mm-hmm. and it can happen that everything works in the beginning. It can be you're having a perfect warm summer with enough rain and everything works well, but what are you doing in the harvest season? In the harvest season here in Germany, it's in August and September. I'm almost the whole day in the kitchen in preserving my vegetables. And I think if you haven't done it before, it might be natural for you. I don't know. But if not, then for me it wasn't in the beginning. You're totally overwhelmed by just by the high amount of vegetables you're getting, and you don't want to give it away to friends or family or whatever. It's nice, but then you're not longer self-sufficient, so you want to store it and you want to preserve it. And so I think just start small and grow bigger. As soon as you're used to the work and as soon as you exactly know what to do and so on. Otherwise, just too much. Because it's hard work.
It is.
Even if it's a lifestyle, it's a hard working lifestyle, and you have to love it. Otherwise, it's not the right thing for you. Otherwise, perhaps it's perfect for you to grow some tomatoes and some cucumbers during summer, and that's it. I'm running some gardening workshops at our community school and our local community school, and I always want to encourage the people to write their stories down, to write down what they're doing, and to reflect on it. And even if some things are going wrong, just to have a look, why have they went wrong, and what can I do for the next season? What can I do to make it better? Just to learn by what you are doing. And try everything, really try everything. If it makes sense or not, just try. If you want to try it, try it.
Yeah.
Nothing can happen.
I just wanted to thank Tini from Cassiolino for chatting with me this week and speaking about how she lives self-sufficiently in her urban backyard. She's doing a fantastic job. If you'd like to follow along with her journey, you can find her on Instagram and you can also find her blog. It is in German, but if you go onto your PC, you'll find a translation button and you can translate it to any language you like. And I was able to translate it to English and read all about her journey and her tips and tricks and some of the recipes she likes to use. So I'll leave all those links in the description below. She also offers gardening tours if you live close to her and online courses. In fermenting and preserving and growing her own food. So you can find all that info in her blog, which I'll leave linked below so you can find it. And I really encourage you to go find her Instagram page because it really is beautiful. It's full of color and information in both English and German. Thank you so much for joining us on this week's podcast, and we will see you next week. Goodbye.